So continuing with the surface, so we were defining the curvature of the surface. So earlier also I tried to explain that there are two components of our curvature. One is coming from the curve itself and one is coming from the surface curvature. So mathematically those curvatures are can be taken in two components. One is along the surface the tangent plane of the surface, and another is towards the normal of the surface. And to get some more clarity, let's have a big globe, and along the equator let's make a curve, and the curve's normal will also lie will point towards the center of the globe, and the surface which it will make will also make the normal towards the center of the globe. But if we make a small arc on the globe, if we make a small arc, small semicircular arc on the globe, then the normal of the arc will lie on the tangent plane of the local tangent plane at that point, while still the surface is like that and the surface normal is still towards the center of the globe. So here we can appreciate the difference between two normals. One normal is towards the actual normal of the surface and one normal is towards the center or the normal of the arc. So that's what will help us to get the correct curvature or the correct normal of the surface. So let's say we have r of u comma v, which is same as some parameters and some r of u, some curve, and the r dash or alpha dash will give the tangent, or the normalized r dash will give the tangent, unit tangent vector. So and then dt by ds will give the normal to the curve. Dt by ds is the normal to the curve. So in the normal direction, and kc is the curvature, or we can include kc in normal, unit normal, and we can write kc as the vector, that is the normal vector to the curve, and nc is the unit normal and kc is the curvature of the curve. K underscore c, that is for subscript, that is for the curvature. So that normal to the curvature curve, or the curvature component of the curve, we saw that one component is towards the actual normal of the curve and one is towards the normal of the surface. So there are two normals. So one normal is aligned to the normal of surface. Here also there is some component of the normal towards the center of the curve and one normal towards the center of the surface. And so one is towards the normal of surface, another is aligned in the direction of the tangent of surface, taking the components of the actual normal of the curve. So this kg, which is the tangent to the, which is a component towards the tangent of the surface, is called as geodesic curvature. And that is independent of surface, because in whatever direction the surface is, it is even curved or not curved, this kg will exist. And that is the curvature of the arc itself. Like the surface may be flat, so there is no curvature of the surface, but if we make a circle on it, then still we have a normal. So that is kg is that normal without the component of the curvature of surface. And then kn is the contribution towards the surface curvature or the surface normal, and we want to define this curvature of the surface purely. So kn will be dt by ds dot n, because dt by ds was the curve's normal, right? This was curve's normal, and if we take the normal the dot product with the normal of the surface, we'll get the curve, the component towards the normal of the surface. That's what we want, right? We want the component towards the normal of the surface. So this t can be written as, So this is same as this, and we can do this manipulation because t dot n cap is 0 and we differentiate it with respect to s. So t dot n, so dt by ds dot n cap plus dn by ds dot t is equal to 0. So this will be same as negative of this, right? And t is dr by ds. So this is minus of dr dot dn by ds square. So ds square is again the square of the distance, that is first fundamental form. E du square plus 2f du dv plus g dv square. E was ru dot ru, f was ru dot rv, g was ru rv dot rv. Okay, and this is negative. So please make this change also. Sir in professor may not carry forward this negative in class. Here also it's negative. And again when we define the distance from the tangent plane, this distance from the tangent plane, we got similar expression, right? Ru du square. So because we can make that change everywhere, from double derivative to single derivative distributed. So that this dot product will give L du square plus 2m du dv plus n dv square. So this curvature we can see is a function of LMN, that is one thing, EFG, and then du dv also. So du and dv are the distance traveled perpendicular to corresponding directions along the direct along some directions. So that relative distances will matter. Like if one of the distance is zero, the direction will be different. Two of the distances are there, will have some specific direction, because like if we have du1 and dv0, then we are traveling along du or the u direction. Similarly, if dv is 1 and du is 0, we are purely traveling towards v, and both are equal, then we are traveling at in the direction at a 45 degree from u and v both. So the magnitude of du and dv will determine the direction of traveling, and hence the curvature of the surface is the function of the direction of traveling from the point. So let's say dv by du is L, x, and we can make that change in the formula for kn, and kn will change like this. Now now let's continue from there. So we want to find the minimum and the maximum curvature of the surface at a point, like in what direction we'll have minimum and in what direction we'll have the maximum curvature. So we differentiate this. So we have written this taking denominator 2kn, we have written this again, then we differentiate it, and to get the minimum and maximum points we'll put dkn by dx 0. So we are left with kn is equal to m plus nx upon f plus gx, and we also know that kn is this thing, right? So making manipulations on them, we can take x common over here, x common over here, using componendo and dividendo, because e plus fx is a fraction which is getting added to the original thing. We can think like that. So kn will eventually become like this. So this is directly coming from here, and using componendo and dividendo, we can use kn's formula over here, right? And then independently using this one and this one, we can get two equations, and there are two variables x and kn, and two equations, two variables, and the resultant force is 0 0. So we want to find x, the directions, right? First the directions where we'll get minimum and maximum, and then we want to correspondingly find the minimum curvature and the maximum curvature. So for that we should say that the coefficient matrix determinant must be 0, because if that's not 0, we'll not get the value of x, that will be 0 otherwise. So putting the coefficient, the determinant of the coefficient matrix is equal to 0, we'll get two values of kn, and that is becoming a quadratic equation. And using the properties of quadratic equation, the product of roots is equal to c by a, we'll get k mean into k max is equal to this thing, ln minus m square upon eg minus f square, and that is eventually also equal to determinant of second fundamental form. So this is the second fundamental matrix form and its determinant, and this is the determinant of the first fundamental matrix, and this product k mean into k max is said as Gaussian curvature, and its physical interpretations are very important. If it is zero, we say that at least in one direction the curvature is remaining same. So in at least one of the direction surface is planar. If it is greater than zero, we must say that in all directions the curvature is getting the surface is getting curved and in the same direction, right? Like it's like a paraboloid. So in all directions the surface is getting curved in the same way, in the same direction from the tangent plane. Then we'll get positive Gaussian curvature, and we'll get negative if we have something like this. So in one direction, and this is in the opposite direction to the tangent plane. Right, these spheres will have positive Gaussian curvature, and hyperbolas will have negative Gaussian curvature. And let's continue from wherever we stopped here. So that the sign of the Gaussian curvature gives the nature of the point. So when Gaussian curvature is zero, then we say that either k mean or k max has to be zero. That is, either in one direction the surface is flat. Like in cylinders, we'll have curves in one direction, but in the another direction it is flat. And in torus, let's see torus thing. So torus, which is a donut type of case, this is the front view. So like from there we have put the torus like this. And you view from that side, that view is over here. So all the points which are touching this surface, this tangent plane, will have a curvature zero because they are not getting curved in one of the direction. Similarly for the top plane thing, and for this outermost points, all the points which are at the outermost periphery, they'll have positive Gaussian curvature. And which are at the innermost points, this will have the negative Gaussian curvature. So that's all. Let's put. So to appreciate this mathematically, that we have different Gaussian curvature for surface and the curves. So let's take this very simple surface, which is a wavy sinusoidal surface, and this tangent dr by ds will give the tangent of the, we are basically finding the normal to the curve and normal to the surface, and this is the normal to the curve. So one, this is the normal to the curve, this will give the, and this will give the normal to the surface by ru cross rv, and we can see that at some value of u, this can get to zero because still they are yet to be differentiated. So for some value of u, this can get to zero, but for any value of u, this will definitely not get to zero, right? Because that is one constant minus one, and here also it will be at least one. This is cos square, right? So we can say that Gaussian curvature, the surface curvature and normal curvature are two different things. And critically, you must see that singular point is defined using the surface normals. That surface normal are getting zero, then we can say that the point is singular point. Okay. And let's do this very interesting thing, which is a simplification for the Gaussian curvature thing. that we can make some Gauss map, Gaussian map. So we have simple surface u v grid, and we are going to relate the normals of the surface over here to a normals on the unit sphere. So we can take any point P, we get the surface normal, and then we translate that. So this point translated to the center of the sphere, and this normal will touch to some point on the unit sphere. Similarly, we can take all the points on this surface and translate them to the center, and we'll get corresponding points on the periphery of the unit sphere. So the Gaussian curvature can also be defined as the area which these points on the periphery are contributing to, the summation of the area of coming from these points divided by the area on the surface itself, the original surface. So that ratio is also giving Gaussian curvature. So for example, let's take sphere first. So we have a sphere surface, and all the of radius r. So from that, when we take the normals from all the points, we'll get some area, that is total area of the sphere, and when we translate them to corresponding unit sphere, we'll get all the whole area, whole surface area of the unit sphere also. So the ratio will give 1 by r square. That's the Gaussian curvature, because the minimum curvature is also 1 by r, the maximum curvature is also 1 by r, product will be 1 by r square. So there is correspondence between the two concepts. Similarly, for a plane, we have a planar surface, and we take all the points on the plane, all the normals will lie in only one direction. We translate them to a unit sphere. We have a point, only a single point on which all the normals will lie, and hence the area on the sphere is negligible, right? The area of this point will be negligible, and here there is whole area of the surface. Hence, the Gaussian curvature is zero, and that's what we can find using the Gaussian curvature formula also. And there is some proof, but we are going to skip that proof. And now we can relate this Gaussian curvature with what we studied here, the distance from the tangent plane. So there is correspondence between them also. That will help to relate the concept. So we know the Gaussian curvature was defined like this, k, and the distance from the tangent plane was defined like this. So we can take the direction x again as dv by du, and we get this equation, quadratic equation, differentiating it and getting two roots. So this m square minus lm will define how many distance x values we can have, the direction values. So if m square is greater than ln, then we'll have two values of x, which will give some same curvatures, and that points will. So if there are two values of x, we'll say that point as an the point surface as an hyperbolic surface. If m square is equal to ln, then there is only one unique direction, and that point is said as parabolic point. So we have a paraboloid, and when m square is less than mn, then there are no points where d will be zero, right? So that is called as a elliptic point. And when relating this distance d with the Gaussian curvature, so when we have a hyperbolic surface, the Gaussian curvature is negative. When we have a parabolic surface, then the Gaussian curvature is zero, because in one direction the distance will remain same. So it's like a paraboloid like this. So at this point all the distances are zero. So in that direction distance remains zero. And when we have m square less than ln, that is we have an elliptic point, we have a positive Gaussian curvature. Okay. Next we'll see the modeling, surface modeling mathematically. How we can model the surface.